Sometimes the microcosmos can take a little while to surprise. You have to be patient, enjoying the familiar sights as you wait for something new. Like right now, we're looking at something that's quite common on our channel, cyanobacteria. But it's setting the stage for things that get more and more unique for us. Like this maze, that's actually an organism. These samples came to us from a shore somewhere in Portugal. James, our master of microscopes, had met some nice people at a party and naturally began following them on Instagram after. A day or two later, they shared some pictures from their vacation along a Portuguese shore. And the thing that stood out to James were the rocks. They were covered in biofilm, and he just had to know what could be living inside of them. So he asked his new friends to bring him back some samples of those biofilms in a bottle of water. James spent weeks watching those samples after they arrived. The cyanobacteria we saw at the beginning of this video were probably the most abundant organisms in his sample. And that's hardly surprising. These photosynthetic prokaryotes have survived for somewhere around 3.5 billion years, showing up in all sorts of environments. It feels like they've basically been everywhere forever. And while they are unicellular organisms, cyanobacteria can come together to form colonies and filaments, which are often encased, like you can see here, in a mucilaginous sheath. Those sheaths can serve as protection, keeping the cyanobacteria safe from UV radiation or from losing water. And in times when the cyanobacteria do get dried out, the sheath may be able to help them trap moisture as they emerge from desiccation. And given the prevalence of cyanobacteria, they sometimes get a front row seat to the cuter side of the microcosmos, like these euploides in the middle of division. You can see the cilia fused together into larger structures called cirri as they beat along the side edge of the organism. And eventually, they scamper off, one euploides having become two. So yes, cyanobacteria, familiar. And I'm sure our next organism seems like a familiar sight too. Yes, it's a tardigrade. And we've seen a lot of tardigrades on our journey through the microcosmos. But this genus was completely new to James, which means it's also completely new to our channel. The genus is called Echinoscoides, which is a group of marine tardigrades. And what was especially adorable about these tardigrades to James is that if you look right under the mouth area, you can see a bunch of little fuzzy dots. Those are actually bacteria. It's like the tardigrade has a beard of them. It's tempting to think that maybe the tardigrade is able to somehow nibble on its bacterial beard, especially since it's a convenient meal parked right next to the tardigrade's mouth. But unfortunately, we weren't able to turn up any research that could explain the possible existence of bacterial exobionts on this tardigrade genus. So we don't actually know for sure that the tardigrade is carrying a to-go meal of bacteria around its mouth. And perhaps less enchanting, though still quite noticeable, are the tardigrade's claws. One species from this genus is known to have anywhere from 7 to 13 claws on each leg. It really puts the bear in water bear. Unfortunately, after about a week of receiving these samples, the tardigrades began to disappear, and the populations began to shift. In this little world that James was watching, the abundance of bacteria fed and fueled the growth of ciliates. But these growing populations may have also made it harder for other organisms to survive because they began consuming all of the oxygen. And as other species began to die off, James noticed a shift in his samples. That's when he noticed this. It doesn't look that appealing from this far away. In fact, it looks like someone blew their nose all over a microscopy slide. But up close, we can see what is, to us at least, an unusual amoeba. We don't know what species it is. We just know that it's yellow and filled with nuclei. And its body shifts around with that familiar shapelessness we know and love. But James also came across a shape that was almost alien to him. Like the amoeba, it seemed to spread over a world of decay. But the way it did so was different. Whatever organism he was looking at didn't have the same movement and globby quality to it like the amoeba's. Instead, it seemed like a network of branches, radiating outward. As James looked at it, he couldn't make sense of what he was seeing. So he turned to a microbiologist named Dr. Kenneth Dumack for help. And Dr. Dumack told James that what was growing on the slide was an interesting protist called labyrinthalomycetes. When a labyrinthalomycete settles onto a surface, it can begin forming tubes that branch out from their cytoplasm. Those branches are anchored to the organism through an organelle called the bothrosome. Those tubes serve a few purposes. They help attach the cells to the surface and also provide a little highway for them to travel along. They can also produce enzymes that break down organic molecules and deliver them to the cells as food. There are two groups of labyrinthalomycetes. One group, called labyrinthalids, can be found on living algae and seagrasses. This sets them apart from throstochytrids, which might be deterred by plant antimicrobials. However, both groups can be found on dead plants, feasting on the decay. Unfortunately, James found only one of these networks, and he was only able to keep it alive for a couple of hours. For James, someone who regularly ventures out and gathers his own samples, these ones that he doesn't collect are their own special surprise. When he looks at them, he can learn more about a habitat far from where he lives. And watching them under the microscope is like putting a puzzle together. This puzzle showed him an increasingly unknown world, with an environment in flux, and where what survives one week may not survive the next. The pieces rearrange as they tell an old story. The world is always changing, and it will always bring you something new. Thank you for coming on this journey with us as we explore the unseen world that surrounds us. And if you enjoy learning on YouTube, why not get credit for it? With the Study Hall channel, you can start taking college courses right here on YouTube. Here's how it works. Watch the course videos on the Study Hall channel for free, then sign up for an online college course led by ASU faculty for just $25 and apply what you've learned. If at the end of the course you're happy with your grade, pay $400, which is about a third of the cost of a college course. And now you have 3 transferable college credits on your transcript. Whether you're trying to learn new skills, earn college credit, or just prove to yourself that you can do it, Study Hall can help you reach your goals without the financial risk. Pick between common Gen Ed college courses like Modern World History, Code and Programming, Human Communication, and more on the Study Hall channel. Check out the link in the description or go to gostudyhall.com to learn more. We'd also like to say thank you to each and every one of our patrons. Some of their names are on the screen right now, and these are the people that make this channel and videos like this possible. And we are so, so grateful. If you'd like to become one of them, you can go to patreon.com/journeytomicro. If you'd like to see more from our master of microscopes, James Weiss, you can check out Jam and Germs on Instagram. And if you'd like to see more from us, there's probably a subscribe button somewhere nearby.